More than 3 weeks,
I think we had about a month to share on that. So for Enya,
Bosomi, Edith, Echere, Yekasa, Yabra, Bonumu, Ewa Bosomi, Bako.
How many of us remember that when you speak, you are releasing seeds? That any time you talk, you are sowing seeds either to affect your destiny or to destroy your destiny. How many of us believe? How many of us remember? We also said that when you speak, you are releasing spirits. Tap your neighbor by yourself. Tell your neighbor that welcome to church. Tell your neighbor, make sure you speak good about me. Because words are powerful. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's a good point to clap your hand. I showed you 4 ways that our speeches and our languages and our expressions are influenced. Influences, things that affect the way we speak. The first had to do with the things you see with your eyes. The things you hear with your ears. What was the third one? Your experiences or circumstances. Your experiences and your circumstances is a way of influencing the way you talk. That is why you have to be careful when you are speaking under the heat of anger. Because the experience around you, the environment you create around you, has a way of making or unmaking your future. This Sunday morning in the month of March, I'm beginning another series that I have titled Unbeatable Prosperity.
Amen.
Amen. God's recipe for unbeatable prosperity. Say God's recipe for unbeatable prosperity. Your background is not good, and the words you are using sounds very blur from behind. So you need to check it out. The background, I think, is not good. Amen. Go with me to 3 John 1 verse 2. I'm reading from the New American Standard Version of the Bible.
Verse 2.
Beloved, I pray that in all respects you may prosper and be in health, just as your soul prospers.
Yohane wuma atoso mi ensa etiba akuni mu mienu oso odofo me bo mpa yesa ade nyinaa mu ensi wiye ne nya anho odin se de esi wo kra yiye.
I would want all those at the back to stop whatever engagement and pay attention to
mama wo kiran ade mu ye nyinaa epese mu ja ne de so fo ye mu dimuni eba.
What I'm doing now is important for which you are sitting down.
De ye ye nse sia no enho wan faso ye chen de wo to a wo ye no.
I'm saying it's more important. That is why we are sitting down. Amen.
Amen.
The scripture says, I wish above all things. I wish above all things that you will prosper and be in health, even your soul prospers. Amen.
Amen.
That is God's desire for somebody this morning. God is not in heaven and is recounting the numerous sins you have committed. God is not in heaven and is recounting the number of times Ahab have gone contrary to his word. But he is up there and looking at you and thinking and imagining and wishing that you will prosper and prosper well. Somebody say, hey, God is thinking about me. Say, God is thinking about me. He says, I pray that all things you may prosper in all things. Amen.
Amen.
So when you become a Christian, God's mind for you is for you to prosper. I said, when you become a Christian, God's plan, one of the cardinal plans and programs of God, is for you to prosper. But like you know, it doesn't come on a silver platter. How many of us have ever tasted fried rice before? Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many of us have ever tasted Malta Guinness before? How many of us have tasted Coca-Cola?
Coke.
Wow. How many of you have tasted Tramadol before?
Who is that
in the church? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Is there anybody who has ever tasted marijuana? Hey, don't tell me he's not here. Just have a flashback into the old days.
Hallelujah.
Most of things we enjoy to eat, the things we desire as food, things we desire as drink, things we taste and they sound very good, they pass through our throats, we don't get them on a silver platter. You don't wake up tomorrow and it's ready sitting on your table. It goes through a lot of process. Amen.
Amen.
It goes through series of processes. Then the finished product is delivered to you. So when you go to a shop and you buy Malta Guinness, and it tastes good in your throat, you don't consider the several processes it has been through before the final product was delivered to you. Everything that looks good comes with a price. Prosperity, as we talk about, also comes with a price. Want to be prosperous in life? There are things you must do. And those things are what I have termed recipe. Who did the cons in school? Economics. You read economics. Who is a caterer here?
One is caterer.
Hey, then my man, you have trouble. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you don't have caterers in the house,
then
men should be praying. The kind of foods wives should be preparing for you to enjoy,
it
will be wonderful to behold. Praise the living God.
Amen.
Because when you want to prepare a delicious meal as a caterer, you must have a recipe. Do we have science students in church? Who is studying or reading science? Only a few of you. Remember your science lessons about apparatus. What are apparatus? The science students. What are apparatus? They are what? Give me microphone. Hey, Let the science teacher explain to you. Someone asked to them, don't know what is apparatus, but you know the T square and the C square.
Mpacho, apparatus here. Enema, vansi ya diensa susumu, ebi ya glass, ebi ya measuring instruments, tise thermometer, nina sifo. Ebi ya instruments, ebi nsu ya glass, di, ya enema na. Ope se wo ye experimenter. Se wo shishe, sa enema na ye friend apparatus no. Se debe ya, experiment na wo ye no. Adibi ya pesa wo so ewe, pansa bodie mu nyansa eyi bia science ni bia ka na nso pese wo pese hunu se saa eyi na asem no ye no kre abra wo di saa eyi no approve no se wo hyehye no ne kwan so.
Thank you.
Na itimi eye
from JHS lesson learn about osmosis and diffusion and all that. You remember those who went to JHS? Osmosis, diffusion. You have to get certain ingredients, certain apparatus. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
If you don't have them, you will not be able to produce effective results. So as I talk with you about God's recipe for unbeatable prosperity, I'm talking about the ingredients you need. I'm talking about materials you need. I'm talking about resources you need. If you have these materials and resources and equipments in place, then you get the right formula or the right method to be applied. Then your prosperity becomes assured and secure. It's a powerful place to give the hands to Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So when the Bible says, I wish above all things that you prosper, God is desiring that the church experiences genuine prosperity.
But
we must get the ingredients right. We must get the recipe right. Now the unbeatable prosperity of God has two sides. When I say the unbeatable prosperity of God, number one, I'm talking about prosperity that affects your soul, your spirit, and your body. Unbeatable prosperity, I'm talking about the prosperity that will affect your spirit. The prosperity that will affect your soul and then your body. Amen.
Amen.
Those from behind, can you see? I want to believe that God has made it possible for the church to work in this multifaceted dimensional prosperity in the church. Amen.
Amen.
Then unbeatable prosperity. We are talking about prosperity that does not depend on your physical background, human wisdom, and then economic state of a country.
Please
turn out all the fans. Put out the fans. Amen.
Amen.
So you just finished dancing. You can't be sleeping whilst I'm preaching. Amen.
Amen.
So when I say God wants you to prosper, I'm not talking about prosperity that is dependent on your physical energy. I'm not talking about prosperity that is dependent on your human wisdom. I'm not talking about prosperity that is based on any political government in the country. There are people who get prosperous during the regime of NDC. When there is a switch and another government is in power, their prosperity comes down. There are others who get prosperous prosperous when the regime of NPP takes over.
But
when there is a switch in government, their prosperity comes down. But there are those, whether there's NDC or NPP or PUC or PKC, their prosperity is solid. It's a prosperity that is not based on the economic state. It's not based on my talent and my giftedness. It's not based on my background because my father was rich and have inherited a blessing. Therefore, it must be a prosperity that is standing on something we cannot see. So in this message and then in this series, I will show you some of the spiritual pillars of this unbeatable prosperity. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
Say, God wants me to be prosperous. Come on. God wants me to be prosperous. What time? God wants me to be prosperous. So as an introduction part to the message, today is just introduction. And I want to show you that God is not against the prosperity of his children. I'm saying God is not against the prosperity of his children. If this message cannot ignite something in you, then I don't know who will speak for you to give a better response. I don't know the footballer who will score a goal for you to shout. Because I'm having a good message for you this morning. That God is against your prosperity. Some of us have a wrong understanding of God. That understanding is not making us to serve God and serve him well. We have an inherited notion, an inherited version of God. And that version tells me that if I become committed to serving God, I'll be poor. That is the way some of us we see God. If I become committed to God, I'll be poor. And so therefore, let me balance my Christianity in some way. So you become a Christian, but you are balancing between the beliefs of God and the beliefs of the world. I have a good news for you this morning. God is not against your prosperity. God is not against you having a lot more in life. And I want to give you briefly 10 reasons why God is not against your prosperity. Number one, God is not against your prosperity because the joy of every king is to see his children flourishing and being prosperous.
So
the joy of every king.
Hey,
talk to me, church. The joy of every king is to see his children flourishing. The joy of every king, every father, is to see his children moving in blessings. Is that not true, church? Talk to me. Is that not true? God is a king. God is a father. If indeed we are the children of this big God in heaven, it is never his dreams for his children to remain poor. Read Psalm 35 and verse 27. Let them shout for joy and be glad who favor my righteous cause. Let them say continually, the Lord be magnified, who has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. Say, wow. God has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. I say God has pleasure pleasure in your prosperity.
Your
amen is looking for my trouble. Your amen is sick enough. Let your amen receive revival. God is not against your prosperity. He says, I take delight when I see my children walking in prosperity. I take delight when I see my church flourishing. I take delight when I see my church increasing. By this message, I pray to the God of the heavens that we will walk in this unbeatable prosperity. Reason number two, God is not against your prosperity. Because the city of God or the church can spread abroad by its prosperity. The church can only spread abroad. The church can spread. We can have so many branches, so many pastors, so many missionaries when we walk in prosperity. Let me ask you a question. If one day you were there and I called you.
So that problem is awful for you. Separate, maybe I'll turn that thing on
you. The moment you came, I told you, Samuel.
I brought my brother Samuel.
We have a nice house for you.
Me see fear for my soul be a man.
With the car parked in front.
Me the car see no man.
They want you to be a servant of
God. Me person we yanya miyakuwa.
They've given you a place to lay your head.
My baby.
Then you have a car to drive your family.
Would
you respond to the call or you not?
Amen.
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 Amen, church.
Amen.
So you see that God takes delight because the church can spread abroad by its prosperity. This church was spread when we have a lot of you turning into prosperous guys and prosperous women.
You
didn't respond. You don't believe what I'm saying.
Amen.
See, the way you are quiet speaks a lot about your own identity.
Can be before one
because I
be
home. Because I've told you your language is your life. This preaching I'm preaching is all about prophetic declarations and prophetic insights I'm bringing to your understanding. You don't have to sit idle like I'm delivering quinine tablets. If something is very exciting, you need to smile, receive it, and encourage it. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
Zechariah 1:17 says, my city through prosperity shall yet spread abroad. Third reason why God is not against our prosperity. Third reason why God is not against your prosperity. God is not against your prosperity because He affirms His promises to the patriarchs, prophets, kings, and the apostles with unbeatable prosperity. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The patriarchs, I'm talking about Abraham, was a prosperous man.
Abraham.
According to Genesis 24 verse 1, Abraham was a prosperous guy.
Now Abraham, your default.
According to Genesis 28 into 29, then up to 32, 33, Jacob was a prosperous guy.
Jacob was not a DA or Moses woman.
Talk about Joseph, he was a prosperous guy.
Joseph, no, no, so
talk about David, he was a prosperous guy.
David, so, no,
so you see, God confirmed His promises to the patriarchs and the prophets. He confirmed His promises to the kings. Then He confirmed His promises to the apostles. Read for me Acts chapter 4, verse 32 and then 33. 4 and 35.
Acts 4.
Say Acts 4.
Asumafo nyuma.
32, 33 and 35. Amen. The multitude of them who believed were of one heart and soul. Not one of them said that out of the things. My friend, change the version. What is it? Who told you to use this? What version is this? Amen.
Amen.
The apostles testified powerfully to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. God's great blessing was upon them all. There were no needy people among them. Can you see it?
Yes.
There were what? Talking about the New Testament church, there was not a single person in the church who had a want
or
was even in need. Verse 35. Well, go back to 34. There were no needy people among them because what happened? Those who own lands or houses. So those who own what? Those who owned. May you be an owner of lands.
Amen.
And may you be an owner of houses.
Amen.
The scripture is showing you that they were not renting people's homes. It seems like now about 90% of us, we rent homes and houses.
I say
and people's buildings. But these guys were honest. I'm talking about honest.
I speak to
somebody who is ready for me. By the way, nobody should be sleeping. And I'm expecting people to be taking notes. God wants you to be an owner of something.
I said, he wants
you. I'm talking to you. You are the one I'm talking with. Your attention. Sometimes you allow the worldly issues to beat you down. So when you're hearing good news, you can't even respond. So they were owners of houses. If they were owners of lands and houses, talk about cars.
So
I believe they were owners. Aeroplanes. They own a lot. Do you know that Peter was an owner of a certain, not just a boat, I want to say the whole ship field. Probably was the owner over the ship industry. Peter was the owner. So when Jesus got to the shore and he needed a boat to preach, he said, "Hey, Peter,
can
you offer me your boat to do kingdom business?" Who was the owner of the fish industry and all the boats belong to him? He said, "Lord, choose one." He said, "Push it close. Take it from offshore. Let it be on the water." Then Jesus began to preach the gospel. I want you to understand. Kingdom Parish. This is not where you belong. I said, this is not where you belong. Tell somebody, this is not where I belong. Tell your neighbor, this is not where you belong. God is telling you, this is not what you where you belong. There is bigger things ahead. There are mega things ahead. I said there are bigger things ahead. There are mega things ahead. There are powerful things ahead. I want the faith of somebody to come alive. As a state God has given you. It is a state you have rather chosen. I said it's a state you have rather chosen. This is where God has put me. Don't tell me that this is where I belong. This is my portion. This is where I've been brought to. This is the blessings God has. No. You have chosen to accept that state for your life. This is not where God wants you to be. But you have chosen to be there. Couple of some days ahead, I will show you. Number 4. The 4th reason why you must believe that God is not against your prosperity is because Jesus, or he sent Jesus Christ to redeem us from the curse of poverty. Amen.
Galatians 3:13.
Jesus came to redeem redeem us from the curse of poverty. Say with me in the name of Jesus. Say with me in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
By this message,
I'm coming out.
Breaking the powers of ancestral curses.
Breaking the powers
of demonic influences. Affecting my prosperity.
In
the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Your amen is weak, some of you.
Amen. I know I'm ready.
Put our hands together.
But with some years,
curses, everyone hanging on the tree. So Jesus took away our curses.
The creator of fire, no many will be a sign with you.
So he took away our curses.
The creator of fire, no me.
He took at it.
Of fire, here no.
Say, my poverty has been taken away.
I said, me here no. Your father call.
My poverty has been taken away.
Me here no. Your father the call.
If you can still see poverty in your life, you have gone and carried it yourself. I'm telling Jesus, not a carrier of both blessings and curses. He carried the curse away and replaced it with a blessing. Why are we then poor? It's because of something you don't know. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
I see a lot of prosperous people in church. I see that you are chosen to be prosperous, and your seeds after you will also experience this prosperity. Reason number 5, why God is not against your prosperity. God is not against my prosperity because Jesus has sent us to do greater works. John 14:12.
Say,
Jesus has sent us to do greater works. I want you to take note of them. Jesus, my friend, they need the points. They are crying for points. Give it to them. If you can get the point, listen to the preaching because it's on record.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You and I have been sent. The church is a church on a mission. We have been sent to do better works. We have been sent to take the gospel to the poor. We have been sent to take the gospel to the needy. Now, do you know that we have not even started 1/4 of this work? Kingdom Parish, hear me. We have not just stepped into the 1/4. Go to prison. There are people in prison. Prison ministries. Talk about hospital ministries. We are not there. Talk about other areas of ministries. We are not there. All we know to do is to come and sit here. Give something small to God. Jump and dance and scream. Then you go back home. The church is a church on a mission. I said we are a church on a mission. That is why this morning I asked you to go out. We are on a mission here, and we can't do it without this spiritual power of God working in our lives. The unbeatable prosperity of God. Father, cause angels to release these blessings. Father, cause angels to unlock the gates of heaven. Cause angels to unlock the gates of darkness.
Amen.
Whatever is blocking the flow of the blessings of this house,
Jesus,
I stand in the office as an apostle.
Amen.
I command a supernatural opening.
Amen.
A spiritual opening.
Amen.
A spiritual opening.
Amen.
May somebody under the sound of my voice, Jesus, receive supernatural strength.
I receive it.
The favor to walk in unbeatable prosperity. It will fall on you in the name of Jesus. Like the early morning on tender plants. May this grace begin to manifest manifest in your life. We are here for a greater work. We are here to reach the unreached. We are here to be a blessing to so many people. We are here to encourage others to serve the Lord. We are here to do a lot of crusades. We are here to go on missionary works. We need cars for the work. We need equipments and instruments. We cannot remain at this giving one CD and two CDs as offering to God. You must rise up and step into another realm where you begin to experience the prosperity God has for you. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Put your hands together. Point number
6.
God is not against your prosperity because Jesus told us to occupy till he comes.
Hey.
Jesus told us to occupy. Say, I am here to occupy. Come on, say, I'm here to occupy. If you don't rule, something will rule you. That's life.
Oh.
It's either you are occupying or something is occupying you. Either you are bringing influence or you have been brought under the influence of something. But Jesus told the church to occupy till he comes. In the parable of the talent in Luke chapter
19,
go with me and read what the scripture says. He gave somebody 5 talents. He gave another person 2 talents. Then he called the third one and gave him 1 talent. Then the servant or the master said, occupy till I come back. I say, occupy till I come back. Occupy till I come back. Occupy till I come back. So God is looking at what we are doing. Are we occupying or we are just existing? Which of them? We are existing. No. But we are not occupying. What does it mean to occupy? Have influence. Let people know that there is a church called Kingdom Parish. Let people know that somebody called Finn came to lead us. Let people know that once upon a time a young lady lived attending Kingdom Parish like Mother Teresa, and she was an influential figure. Mother Teresa is dead, but we talk about her. Talking about people who occupies in their generation. Are you an occupant or you have been occupied? God wants you to occupy in life. I am rising up to occupy. I'm rising up to occupy. I'm rising up to have dominion. To rule over every element of nature.
Who
seem to bring it to the state of a beggar. This is the season every man, every woman under the sound of my voice, who is not up to 30 years in this house. Let me see your hand. You are not up to 30 years. Or you are even in your early
30s.
Listen to me. This is the best times of our lives. God is challenging us to occupy. We cannot blame our parents for our perils. Whatever we are experiencing now, nobody tells you to go for a girlfriend. That's anybody does that. It tells you that you have the responsibility to rise up and to occupy. 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 God has deposited enough in you. God has deposited a lot of endowment, blessings, giftings, anointings in you. But we are not using them, and therefore we are poor. But from today, you need to rise up.
As a free now, I say,
sorry. You need to rise up.
Free now, I say, sorry.
Don't use devious means, but rise up. Don't accept poverty as a condition that has been programmed by God for your life. We break that spirit in the name of Jesus. We break that power in the name of Jesus. It is only you who don't know that there is something in you, somebody out there wants it. There's something in you that another person needs it. And so you must rise up and occupy. You must rise up and occupy. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
I feel like going to the main sermon next week.
But
this is just the introduction. Point number 7. God is not against your prosperity. Because in the parable of the talents, God was not happy with the unfruitful and unprofitable servant. The servant who was not profitable, God was not happy with him. The unprofitable one, God was not happy with him. If you live your life up to 40 years,
and
there's no profit coming from you, let me tell you, God is not happy about you. God is not happy with your life. You are 30 years, you are 35 years, you are not bringing any profitable venture to God. He's not happy with you. How many of us have gotten to the age of 25? Can I see by hand
25?
25. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do you know the founder of Lighthouse Chapel? How many of us know him? The founder of Lighthouse Chapel. Let me see your hand if you know the founder. Only a few of you. Trust me that you are not into Christianity. You are so superficial. You are krife. You don't know things. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The founder of Lighthouse Chapel, he was 25 years when he started the church.
25
years. And he was a pastor.
No, yes, so for.
Today, if I should be telling somebody to pastor a church,
and they say, you be that, sorry,
you tell me, pastor, allow me to grow.
Yes, so my
allow me to grow.
So my
he was 25 years.
No, we feel the numpe.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We send our children, our daughters, and our sons.
Yes, ma, yeah, ma, ban, yeah, ma, ban,
we send them to school abroad.
Yeah, do school,
even
man,
at tender ages.
Impo, oh,
when you say somebody should work for God, you tell that pastor, I want to grow
first.
One day I witnessed a certain lady.
I said,
what do you do for God?
I said, then where my uncle pon?
Say, I'm schooling.
I said, well, school.
So I know you are schooling, but what do you do in church?
I said, so then we are
so me, I don't really get myself involved in church things, so I'm schooling.
So,
I want to finish schooling and get a job to do, then I'll start doing God
well.
This is the wisdom of you, some of you.
That's
your wisdom. As I want to finish school, get an enviable job, then I can serve God well. Tell somebody, God is not waiting for such people. Hey, talk to your neighbor. All the mothers and fathers here above 30 years, 40
years,
God is still counting on you to be fruitful in his church.
As
a God is counting on you to be fruitful in his church.
Said
that we are old, so we can't do anything.
Yeah,
we are old, pastor. I'm not even well. Should fight sin in the house now. You will see the energy of this so old women and old men in the house. Some of them will be breaking the metallic object to go through the windows. Praise the living God.
Hallelujah.
But it's one it's time for working for God, you come up with a lot of excuses. But we must overcome these excuses. When you are unfruitful, God is not happy with you. Point number 8. Say point 8. God is not against your prosperity, because he gives more to those who have and takes away the little from those who don't have. This is a wisdom that you don't understand about God. He gives more to those who have. Those who don't have, the little they have, he takes away.
Say, hey.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God gives more prosperity to those who have it. Those who say we don't have, God takes away even little you have. Doesn't mean God is a wicked master. No, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Please, I need to get the scripture clear. If you have a mindset like, I'm poor, I don't have. I'm poor, I don't have. I'm poor, I don't have it. The Bible says God takes away the little you have. Then those who say we have it, God says you are speaking well. Take more. Take more. Take more. That is why in the world, the rich keeps getting richer, and the poor keeps on getting poorer. You see a wide gap between the rich and the poor. It has a spiritual connotation, a spiritual principle. He gives more to those who have. Those who don't have, he takes away the little they do have. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
When I studied, it sounded like God was wrong. Why don't God give more to those who don't have? Then those who have it, he keeps subtracting from them. But this God is saying that for those who have, I will keep on multiplying them. If you have given birth to a child before, your chance of giving birth again is very high. If you haven't given birth to a child before, your chance of not giving birth again is very, very high. So by comparison, those who have given birth, they keep on giving more babies out. And those who don't have, even looking for one, they can be praying for years and it's not coming. It tells you that God is against barrenness, and is against you not having it. So that always you come to church and you fold your arms. Or even in your house, if there's something you need to do for God, you can't do it. May the prosperity anointing of God, from the bishop who anointed me, may that prosperity grace find expression in this church. Walk into every facet of the church. Walk into every branch of the church. Prosperity without loans. Prosperity without loans. I said prosperity without loans. You see, we are not experiencing a lot of prosperity. Because about 80% of Ghanaians who are riding and have houses, they have mortgage and loans behind to pay. It will surprise you to know that you are better off than a certain millionaire in town. Ask me why. I said, somebody here, you are better off than somebody millionaires in town. Ask me why. Because not owing somebody is better than owing somebody over millions. So you see, if you have a lot of cars and you are owing somebody, and then I don't own anybody in this world, I'm far better off than you. Zero is better than negative one. Zero is not better than negative one.
So
the reason why we can serve God well, and I'm teaching you this principle, is that you see a lot of people in town, you won't behave like they have a lotto. The secret behind is they are building on loans. So always they are paying and paying and paying.
But
zero is the beginning of everything. Negative is not the beginning of everything. So when you begin from zero, your chance of going up is far better than somebody who has begun with a zero number.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So God wants you to have it. Say, I have it. The fact that you don't owe anybody in this world is an indication that you are blessed. Because the question that comes to mind is, what you don't have and your creditors are behind you. What you don't have and the creditors are behind you. You generate 150 reasons and questions. For that very day, you become an examiner, setting questions for people to answer. When is a day for the creditors to come and take away their money? You start the first plot. Then the second plot. Then the third plot. You line up all your reasons, all your excuses.
Then
sometimes you tell your children that early in the morning, I will run away from this place because a certain so-called Mr. XYZ will come. When he comes, tell him, I have traveled 3 days ago. And you begin teaching your children how to lie right from your
hopes.
But I pray for you that by this anointing, if you are here and you are behind bells, and you are able to settle them, God will release you from that life. God will release you from that spirit. God will release you from that power. If you will allow yourself for the teachings to affect your life, you will have a loan free prosperity. A loan free prosperity. God wants us to be loan free in this world. If it were left alone for me, some banks will collapse.
Ask
him, or he's here, he's a banker.
Listen,
our hard earned money, they give it to them as loans. They use some to cook delicious meals for them. Go to every bank and observe the food they eat and compare to you who go to deposit your money at the bank. The money you have gone to deposit is what they are using to trade. Then they give you an interest rate of 2.55%. The highest becomes 11%. But the last time I checked the Bible, the Bible says good measure pressed down, shaken together, is what God gives as your profit. The banks will give you 5%. But the Bible says 60-fold, 100-fold, 80-fold shall the master give to you in return. If you walk in God's unbeatable prosperity, somebody may start before you, but the first can be the last, and the last can be the first. It is time for the church to arise into the realm of unbeatable prosperity in the name of Jesus. It's a good point to put your hands together for Jesus. Last but one, and we close. God is not against your prosperity, because every good and perfect gift come from him. Say, every good, are you here? Every good and perfect gifts comes from God. Can you see some of these good and perfect gifts? The person sitting close to you is a perfect gift. Somebody, you didn't hear it. You are sitting by perfect gift. You are sitting by a perfect gift. It may not be your size, but it's a perfect gift. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. God did not give these gifts to devils and demons and the people of this world. He made them for the church. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 19 says, that's one scripture, Ecclesiastes 5:19. Can we read? It is a good thing to receive wealth from who? Is it bad? It's a good thing. Say it's a good thing. Come on, shout it. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. To receive wealth from God. And the good help to enjoy it. To enjoy your work and accept your lot in life. This is indeed a gift from God. Put your hands together.
Amen.
So say, God is not against my prosperity, because he is the giver of every good and perfect gift. Point number 10. God is not against your prosperity, because Jesus commanded the first apostles. It will shock you. Hear this. Jesus commanded the first apostles to stay in the houses of rich people for ministry. When Jesus sent the first apostles, he told them that whichever place and town you go, ask for the rich person in that place. Go and dwell there and do ministry. Jesus commanded the first apostles that they should stay in the house of rich people for ministry. Jesus didn't recommend that, go and live with the poor people. Let me ask you from the Bible's point of view. Who was Zacchaeus? Talk to me. Who was Zacchaeus? He was a powerful and
guy.
Jesus was passing by when he saw Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was physically disadvantaged. So he had to climb a tree.
Do you know what I said?
But when Jesus saw him,
he
said, this rich guy, today I will stay in your house. Jesus didn't want to be staying in places where they could not provide for him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Well, what do you think? Ask your neighbor, what do you think? Madam Mary, what do you think? Jesus said, go and sit in the houses of the rich people. So that you'll not be praying always, forgive me my daily bread.
And
wake up and you are praying for souls, for deliverance, for healings, and for miracles. That will be the story of this church and this house. I said it will be the story of this house. Who are those who are not responding? I'm saying it will be the story of this house. Missionary one day.
You
don't know the plans of God. That is why that you are going to be sent to. Now Ghana has 16 regions. Some of you should be ready to go to the remotest part of Ghana. Go there and all you see is mad houses. go and look for the chief of that town and tell him that I am a messenger, an ambassador of Christ. I want a place to sleep so that I can do the work of God. I'm saying God wants us to be rich because he sends people to sleep in the houses of the rich people to do ministry. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Ask your neighbor, what do you think? Ask him one more time, what do you think? Look at another powerful statement. God is not against your prosperity. Because the crucifixion and the death and burial of Christ. It happened in the tomb of a rich guy. The place where Jesus was buried, it was a tomb nobody had slept in before. And that tomb belonged to Joseph of Arimathea. He was a powerful guy. Had a nice place. And when Jesus was hanging, he said, I decide to give my tomb to this man, bury him in this
tomb.
We will be owners of real estates. We will be owners of real estates. We will be owners of real estates. We will give out a lot of things to help the ministry. Finally, God is not against your prosperity because most of the Passover, the Last Supper, Jesus did it in the homes of prosperous
people.
Say amen to that.
Amen.
Amen to that.
Amen.
See, we in Kumasi.
Yeah, we Kumasi ni die.
One thing that is beating Christianity.
Adie ba kwa m wame Kristo sum tu mpejano.
We want the Christianity in Kumasi to be like the Christianity in Accra. Everybody open your eyes and listen. If you had been to a church, most of the churches in Accra, the prophet will preach for 15 minutes. Then he starts entering the spirit. Then he will talk to you a lot about spiritual things. By the time the service is ending, the prophet will generate about 10,000 Ghana cedis in a single service. Because people want to hear a lot. We have itching ears and we want to hear what is happening in the spirit. And so you see, when people come to church and they sit for about 45 minutes and you are preaching to them, look at their faces and their faces want to tell you that shorten your message and close
us.
But you see, if I should switch to another realm, I'm seeing something. I see angels in church. I'm beginning to see angels with bundles of money. I'm beginning to see angels with gold. I'm beginning to see angels with marriage rings.
See,
everybody will be standing and
let.
But I am teaching you what will launch you into unbeatable prosperity. Tell your neighbor you are the reason why pastor is preaching this.
Tell
the pastor is directing the message to you. And he's not afraid of you. Hey.
Hey.
Amen.
Amen.
You have to be stable enough to sit for about 1 hour listening to the preaching of God's word. You listen to some of these comedians for more than 1 hour.
If it were
not be true, those who are football fanatics, you go and watch television, football. You watch football for more than 2 hours.
Like
what I'm saying, tell me it's not true.
It's true. Yeah,
football fanatics. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, boy,
but I want you to have it in the deep. deepest part of your soul,
the
deepest part of your life. God is not against my prosperity. From today, I don't want to hear anybody sounding like God is making you poor. God is not making you poor. You are making yourself poor. Don't sound like it is God who is making you poor. From next week Sunday, I will start to the main message, and you begin to understand why I'm saying you are the reason why you are poor, and God is the reason why you should be blessed. God is the reason why you should be blessed.
Hey,
my boy,
God
is the reason why you should be blessed. My boy, shall we stand? Amen.
Amen.
Opportunity comes, people don't know how to see it as an opportunity. Lift your two hands. I'm going to prophetically pray a certain prayer. It's going to happen for people who are ready for it to happen. Hey, come back. Teaching you how to be stable in church. Amen.
Amen.
Raise your two hands. Tell your neighbor, if you are angry, better change. To receive the good things God has for you. Tell your neighbor, Tell your neighbor again that if pastor is your father, whatever he tells you is good. Tell your neighbor, hallelujah.
Amen.
Put a smiley face on your faces. Hallelujah.
Amen.
No, you can't be clumsy and gloomy and receive from God. Smile like the prosperity of God is on your life. And be willing to receive it as I pray with you and for you. Take a covenant seed into your hands. I'm going to pray for an unbeatable prosperity. Take your covenant seed. Today you can take a special covenant seed. Tell God that this is my seed for unbeatable prosperity. I've already said to you there's a difference between covenant seed and normal offerings. Your covenant seed is not your free will offering. It's a seed of faith. You are throwing a challenge to God. That if what your servant had preached about is true, I'm expecting you to act on my behalf. As you take your covenant seat, read Psalm 3, verse 1, 2, 3.
David, nyom. Miensa.
It's a prayer for you this morning. Lift your covenant seat. He says, oh Lord, I have so many enemies. Does it sound like David is describing somebody here?
David, or Chirobi Abrabo Hana.
I have so many enemies. Those against me. So many people are saying God will never rescue him. Yeah, that is people saying, oh, allow her.
So
she can go out. She cannot be rescued. She cannot be blessed. She cannot be prosperous. Look at her age. Then David says, But you, O Lord, are a shield around me.
One name,
you are shield around me.
One name, what time?
You are my glory.
One name, any munyam.
You are the one who holds my head up high.
Any mitiri peja for.
You are the one who holds my head up high.
We radu na we peja.
God, you are my glory.
We radu one name, any munyam.
My glory is not in any political leader.
Many munyam.
My glory is not found in anyone on earth.
Many munyam. Any ni pebi.
God, you are my glory.
We radu one name, any munyam.
The lifted up of my head.
One name, mitiri peja for.
Lift that up of my head. You will surround me with glory. You will be a shield round about me. Lift your seed and begin to pray this prayer. Many are those who rise against me. Many are the enemies around the church. Many are those seeking for my death. Many are those seeking for my destruction. Many are those seeking for my disgrace. But thou, O Lord,
art
a shield about me. You are my glory and the lifter up of my head. Thou, O Lord, art a shield.
Oh, you
are a shield about me. You are my glory. You are the lifter up my head. You are my glory, the lifter up of my head. Thou, O Lord,
art
a shield about me. You are my glory, the lifter up of my head. Rescue my soul. Rescue my love. Deliver me from the works and the influences of all the so many enemies who rise up against me. The spiritual invisible enemies, the anaconda spirit, different serpentine powers, enemies with seven heads, enemies with seven mouths, enemies with seven eyeballs, enemies with powerful weapons. You are a sword about me, my glory and the lifter up of my head. Help me this day, this hour, this moment, Lord.
Bebre na same same ni pa dia e wo me nyango po mo na wo urade wo ne metem ene mi tri peja fo ena no pe wo ene urade yesu demo opo ne fo mo sori ti a me do su bi e do su bebre urade teme every wo mo sam ma wo bambo entwa me wo esia ma wo cham entwa me wo sia e wo busu mi we mo an pa bone fo wo mo sori e wo de su mo wo wo ni pe bi ara wo mo kura etin so ne anon so urade jimi fo wo mo sise ye mo wo ene urade yesu demo.
Lift up your unbeatable prosperity. Father, I pray.
Jesus.
By the tokens of the blood.
Yes.
By the privileges of sonship.
Jesus.
And by the token of the finished work of Christ.
Yes.
I pray for your church.
Jesus.
Send unbeatable prosperity.
Amen.
Prosperity that has no recognition for economic hardships.
Amen.
Prosperity with our loans. Prosperity with our rents.
Amen.
Rent free prosperity.
Amen.
Rent free living.
Amen.
Provide it for your church.
Amen.
Provide it for your church.
Amen.
Provide it for your church.
Amen.
As we serve you faithfully.
Jesus.
May we be building our houses with ease.
Amen.
May we be building our houses with ease.
Amen.
As we serve you faithfully.
Amen.
Make us owners of lands.
Amen.
Possessors of real estate.
Amen.
As we serve you faithfully.
Yes, Lord.
Release our blessings.
Amen.
Release our blessings.
Amen.
Release our traveling documents.
Amen.
Release marriage documents.
Amen.
Release our financial blessings.
Amen.
Command doors to open unto
Jesus
your people.
Jesus Christ.
Let your favor rest upon us.
Amen.
Let your favor find and rest upon us.
Amen.
Let every scheme of the devil be broken.
In the name of Jesus.
Let curses be neutralized.
Amen.
in this house in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We push back any spirit of scarcity.
Jesus.
We push back the enemies of want and need.
Jesus.
We drive the spirits of sicknesses. Cause us to be planted on a fertile soil.
Amen.
Plant us on a soil.
Amen.
Where we going to flourish.
Yes.
Like a palm tree.
Amen.
Where we going to experience.
Amen.
Your goodness and your mercies.
Amen.
Your favor and your kindness.
Amen.
Somebody receive a breakthrough this week.
I receive it.
Somebody receive a breakthrough this week.
I receive it.
Somebody receive a miracle this week.
I receive it.
Somebody receive deliverance this week.
I receive it.
Somebody receive favor this week.
I receive it.
Somebody receive healing this week.
I receive it.
The anointing to preserve
girls and things.